Good evening, friends. Welcome to the 65th webinar of the Unique VG Track program of the Delhi CSI. We are into the series of case discussions, today the seventh one, and the second on the rheumatic heart disease, because it's one of the most commonly dealt cases in exam. And today we have Dr. Abhishek Thakur from All India Institute of Medical Sciences, along with him, Dr. Zia Abdullah. They will be presenting the case on rheumatic heart disease. We have the privilege of having Dr. N. Sudhay Kumar, Professor and Head of the Cardiology from Kovalam, Travancore Medical College, and our colleague, Dr. Kamal Sharma, who's from UN Mehta Institute of Cardiology, Ahmedabad. Along with me, I have my colleague, Dr. Sumud and Dr. Nitish Nayak today. So I request Dr. Abhishek to switch on his video, start sharing his screen, some hygiene measures. There are other people who are also here. You are requested to participate in the discussion. In case you have questions and comments, you are free to answer and ask also. And after Dr. Abhishek has presented, the investigations, I think, will be presented by Dr. Zia. And this is how the flow will be. All of you who are listening, in case you have any questions, comments, or clarifications, we'll be very happy to take all of them in on the chat box. You can please feel free to write. So over to you, Dr. Abhishek. Have a great presentation and a wonderful discussion.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, respected teachers and all my seniors.
Please switch on your video, Abhishek.
Switch it on, sir. Is it not on? Is the video visible, sir?
Oh,
I think it's disabled by the host, sir.
Please.
Is it on?
Video is not on, but otherwise, you're audible.
I think it is by the disabled by the host. I have my video is on. Abhishek sir, can you go to video settings and select your camera? Selected integrated webcam.
Any problem, Abhishek?
The video and not able just open right now.
I think by the time the screen gets visible, at least, before his video gets on, at least you can start sharing, Abhishek, your screen so that we can, and then you can continue.
Abhishek, you can start the discussion.
Start case presentation. You can work on your camera if you can start it. At least we can have the case presentation rolling.
Sorry for the technical issue.
Maximize the screen, please.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. That's good.
Good evening, respected teachers and dear seniors and dear colleagues.
Isha, voice is not clear.
Yeah. Can you speak a bit louder or closer? I don't know. Is your audio is also low?
Good evening, respected teachers and seniors and dear colleagues. Today I'll be presenting a case on heart disease. My patient.
Dr. Abhishek, you are the exam going student?
Yes, sir. In December.
You are the exam going student. Okay, wish you the very best. Relax and discuss. Okay, fine. Go ahead.
My patient is a 39-year-old gentleman, a resident of Jharkhand, a teacher by occupation. I studied till MA, and the history is given by itself. He presented with chief complaints of palpitations on existential palpitations for the last 12 years and dyspnea and exertion for the last 10 years. However, since his history predates much before that, I'll be starting with his first presentation. The patient was apparently well till 14 years of age. At that time, he developed an episode of multiple joint pain associated with fever. The joint pain started with the right ankle and predominantly involved the larger joints, including the right ankle, then the right knee, the right elbow, the right shoulder joint, and left knee and the left hip joint, without any associated swelling or redness. It was severe enough to limit his daily activities. And in around a week, he started, and during the same time, he started developing palpitation on exertion. However, that time he did not have any any breathlessness. He remembers that he was given injection penidura and tablet Disprin at that time. And the symptoms resolved within 2 to 3 days after that. He continued to, however, despite resolution of his pain, he continued to have exertional palpitation for the next 3 months. After that, his palpitations also gradually improved, and he continued, and he was relatively symptom-free for a long duration. For the last 12 years, he started having palpitation again, and this time he remembers that initially it was started with exertion while cycling at a higher pace or while running. He could feel his heart racing on activities with no sensation of any skip beat, but no symptom and symptoms being resolved, symptoms resolving on rest. He did not have these palpitations at rest. There is no associated dyspnea in the beginning. He noticed that he used to get tired easily with his daily activities. However, around 2 to 3 years later, he started having dyspnea, mostly on exertion, and which is insidious onset and gradually progressive. He was able to carry out his routine activities initially. However, for the last 2 years, he has noticed that his symptoms have increased in severity and with increasing dyspnea at lower level of activity. He also has palpitations at rest, which appear and now for the last 2 years, he also has palpitations at rest, which appear suddenly and relieve suddenly at rest. 2 years back, he had an episode of sudden onset weakness of the left half of the body. He was walking in his school when he suddenly had a weakness of the left half of body and he had facial deviation. And he says that the symptoms resolved within an hour. After that, he had consulted local medical center and was started on some blood thinners. That since then, his dyspnea has worsened over the next 6 months when he started having episodes of acute breathlessness at night, around 2 to 3 hours after night, which used to wake him up from sleep. And he was prescribed some medication that increases urine output and have ameliorated his symptoms. He is on, there's no history of any chest pain, no history of any syncope or presyncope, no history of any neck pulsations, noxious angina, sweating, no history of lower limb edema, abdominal distension pain, yellowish discoloration of skin, no history of cyanosis, no history of prolonged fever. The history suggests of regarding his past medical history, the history suggests of epidermatic fever at 14 years of age. However, there are no such repeat episodes, and is under follow-up at a local hospital and was told to have some heart disease that would requiring a surgical intervention. He is taking 4-weekly intramuscular painter injection, which the patient knows it by name, and he had stopped in between because due to pain, but again has restarted. Regarding the personal history, he takes a mixed diet and doesn't consume alcohol or smoke. He has normal blood boil habits. His sleep is often disturbed and interrupted by episodes of breathlessness, 2 to 3 episodes per week. Even his family history is married with 2 children and no other similar illnesses are in any of his siblings or any other family members. Regarding socioeconomic history, he lives in a pakka house with a separate water supply and separate toilet. 4 people stay in 2 rooms. He earns around 15,000 to 17,000 per month and belongs to upper middle class according to modified Kokosami scale. Should I go ahead with the history summary, sir?
Yes, please.
So here we have a 39-year-old male with history, past history, suggestive of epidermatic fever in childhood and 14 years of age, presenting with volume overload type of palpitation for 14 years, and which is progressed from MHC class 1 to 2, along with insidious onset, gradually progressive dyspnea and exertion from class 2 to class 3 for the last 10 years, which has increased in the last 2 years, and associated with episode of PND, with history of CBA 3 years back. And it doesn't give any history of angina, syncope, or feature size of right heart failure. And he was advised Paul Sarsity as a treatment, and he is on pain durable prophylaxis.
All right, so a couple of things. I mean, your patient must be really having a fantastic memory to remember, you know, joint right upper limb and then right lower limb and then right left over. So usually it's, you can go on. I mean, is this a hypothetical history or you actually had a patient?
No, sir. The patient exactly knows the name of the medications as well.
That is fine. The right limb, then the right upper and the left lower, that sequence is, maybe if he remembers well, I can't argue against it, but I mean, that looks a bit difficult to, you know, be palatable. Anyway, when you are mentioning penicillin injection, right? Yes, the patient has mentioned that. So tell me the differentials. Let's go to your differentials based on this. If you exclude history of penicillin and so-called that he already had a rheumatic, what else comes to your mind?
So most likely valvular heart disease would be the first differential in this case. Likely a regurgitant lesion initially, with a history of palpitations, just not palpitation, and with a history of a long onset of dyspnea for last 8 to 10 years, with one history of most probably a stroke, and
how is history of palpitation different in a patient with regurgitant lesion versus a stenotic lesion versus an MR versus an AR? Are they likely to be different or they are likely to be similar? Can from history, need not always be that you may be able to reach to the diagnosis, but can palpitation, if you dug it a bit in deep, help you in differentiating the site of lesion and type of lesion?
With other differentiating features would be...
MR, AR, yes, MS, yes, NAS... Yes. If the patient has palpitation, if you dig that history of palpitation in detail, can you differentiate the four?
Yeah, there will be features of pulsations, neck pulsations, or nocturnal angina, or sweating. These are two less common.
Just palpitation. How is palpitation different in, say, MR-AR, regurgitant versus stenotic?
If it is in a stenotic lesion, other important cause would be ethmogenic palpitation would be more favoring stenotic lesion.
So in a palpitation, what are the things that you ask? You ask for?
Whether the palpitation start is at rest or at exertion, whether the palpitation is a sudden onset and offset. Whether the palpitations are accompanied by the history of complaints of dyspnea or not, and
character, site,
the character,
intensity,
whether he
feels offset, rate, character,
whether he feels a sensation of skip beat or whether he feels a thumping sensation.
You mentioned neck pulsation. What is the
for in case of prolonged aortic?
Neck pulsation, likelihood ratio of LR of 141 or something is mentioned for one disorder. What disorder? In the clinical examination chapter in Brunwald, the likelihood ratio, which is published from a data from one of the series from the history of palpitation, this associated means this. What is that?
Neck pulsation would indicate.
Yes, indicate.
Yeah.
Read that. There are the new Brunwald mentions lot of associations with a lot of new symptomatology compared to the old Brunwald. The likelihood ratio for everything, symptomatology, for palpitation, for dyspnea, for equivalence, for everything they have mentioned now with data of likelihood ratio. Anything else? How is precordial activity? How is the description of an increased precordial activity different from a palpitation? Can a patient misjudge that? Can a patient get confused between a precordial activity and an arrhythmic palpitation?
The patient will have a thumping sensation of or a racing heart, and that is a typical description that has been given, sir.
You'll say it is increased precordial or force of activity. The other is the rate, of course, right? The onset offset. How is it onset offset? How is it related to exertion, meal, nocturnal?
Onset, offset, sudden onset, and sudden offset would definitely indicate, would probably favor an arrhythmogenic palpitation. Onset and offset, onset at rest would favor an arrhythmogenic palpitation.
Okay, anything else that comes to your mind, removing that history of penicillin and migratory polyarthritis from the rheumatic viewpoint? Anything else that comes into your mind for differential of this kind of a presentation? 14-year history, gradually progressive, over 10 years with two episodes, or 2 years here of PND, history of CVA, anything else? Any other disorder? 39-year-old male.
We remove the penicillin as well as the CVA. MBP MR also would have a long history and palpitations, but that would be more of an.
Any other disorder where you have CVA? What are the?
Even with the bicuspid wall, we are with the
CVA. Okay, how would you get a stroke in a bicuspid valve? What are the associations?
Bicuspid valve is associated with coarct, and
okay, coarct. What is associated with coarct in the brain?
And also in intracranial aneurysm. The intracranial aneurysms also, Bell's aneurysm also associated with coarct. Other is
what do you get in brain?
Bell's aneurysm with
Bell's aneurysm. What is the incidence in coarct? Bell's. What percentage of patients harbor? If you do an MR to all coarcts, how much? What percentage will have Barry's? Which other organ is involved apart from Barry's aneurysm in coarct? One more organ is involved apart from Barry's aneurysm. You can get something else in some other organ in patients with coarct. Any other disorder? Very common. Common disorder. Yes, where you also have history of fever. You also have history of.
And what is of bicuspid valve leading to?
No, that is one. Bicuspid is finished. I'm talking about else. You have vessels involved causing stroke or upper limb involvement, and also a history of fever in childhood. And now he started having dyspnea because of some valvular involvement that can happen rarely in these patients. Some other disorder. Again, something which is very common from Dr. Sudhay Kumar sir's area.
Aorto arthritis also present. Referring to
aorto arthritis or one is aorto arthritis. Then something else that's very common and prevalent in Kerala can present with an embolic stroke, though it will not be a 10-year duration.
EMF.
How is the history of EMF different from this history? Suppose there was a patient of stroke. And he presented with dyspnea. What is not matching EMF in this case history?
Right heart symptoms would also be more of right heart symptom would be present in the EMF, sir.
Anything else? Sir, Sudhay Kumar sir. Say you're muted. Sir.
Yeah. You're okay. You're comfortable with the discussion so far? Okay, fine. Now, because the examiners, Dr. Abhishek, the examiners are of different types, personalities, attitude, all those things. One examiner may be interested in criticizing the way you presented. Another examiner may be interested in asking to discuss DD, all those things. Okay. I may take the other thing because I am a geriatric examiner. I have some suggestions in your presentations. Can we have the slides from slide number 1?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I can be able to modify something. First slide. Okay. Next. Okay.
Sir.
Okay, fine. The problem is, what are the things which should be included in chief complaints? Because when you say 12 years, 10 years, and then you start saying that 14 years back. Was it 14 years back that episode of joint pain which you presented?
14 years of age, sir. I mean, I have
kept... So that was past history. You presented it again in the past history. Now, you said that... So this is 14 years of age when he developed. So what you have to put is this, you should not put it in detail. At postgraduate level, I may present like this. because postgraduates' presentation can be a little different from undergraduates' presentation. The 34-year-old gentleman who is MA postgraduate and a teacher, and that you could have told our Sir Kamal sir that, sir, he's a well-educated person, he's an MA person, so he could recollect. Still, it is extremely difficult for me. But what we need is, that should not come now because you have started 12. But what I usually teach them is, this gentleman who had an episode of fever with polyarthritis at the age of 14 years and remaining asymptomatic has now presented with progressive palpitation on exertion for 12 years and progressive dyspnea progressing from class 2 to class 3 over the 14 years. That is the way you can put it. For postgraduate level, it can go to a little higher level rather than saying that the previous slide. Okay, difficult. Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you can put it like this. There is, rather than telling just complaints, you can put it just writing a novel or describing. Sir, this 39-year-old teacher, an MA postgraduate or a postgraduate in MA, whatever subject it is, who gave history suggestive of rheumatic fever or history of fever with polyarthritis at the age of 14 years and remaining asymptomatic, has now presented with progressive exertional palpitation for the last 12 years and dyspnea on exertion progressing from class 2 to class 3 over the last 10 years. This you can safely present, no problem. Okay. Then next slide. Okay.
Yes, sir.
No, previous one. Okay. Now that you can put it in the past history, because that's a past history, because you have to come back. Okay, now in the present history, you have mainly concentrated on the discussion of present illness. I may agree, but some examiners may not agree because that is past history. Okay, so we have to put the whole thing in the past history. Next slide. Now he was given, it is not penidura, it is penidure, E-R-E. And instead of using this brand name as a postgraduate or a consultant, or when you are prescribing, it should be generic. That is a standard thing. It is a decision by the court also, the MCA also. At postgraduate level, you should start writing that. So what is penidure? What is generic name of penidure? What is it? Penidure is a brand name.
Yes, sir.
What is it?
Anything penicillin, sir.
What penicillin?
Anything penicillin.
Pardon?
Benzathine penicillin.
So you have to say he was put on regular parenteral penicillin prophylaxis. That will be better. So you can put in a better presentation, which will give you more marks. And instead of saying penidura, you have to say a long-acting penicillin, benzathine penicillin. How often you have to tell? Because invariably, there will be questions on penicillin prophylaxis. What is the WHO recommendation? What is the Indian recommendation? What is the ACCHA recommendation? You have to read that. Have you read that? Have you read an article on rheumatic fever? Any recent updates on rheumatic fever? You should read it. There is a recent update which came in 2020, in which one of the Indian is the involved in that in the coordination. Very clear. Now, let me ask one question, which is commonly asked. You cannot make a mistake. No, don't go. No, keep it there.
Yes.
And don't use Disprin. Use aspirin. He was given parenteral penicillin and aspirin managed as rheumatic fever. Okay. And the whole thing subsided. Okay. Fine. So, what is the prophylaxis for rheumatic fever?
Intramuscular penicillin.
Pardon?
3-weekly intramuscular penicillin injections.
How often? What is the dose? How often?
1.2 million. Depends on the
1.2 million units for every people.
For less than, for more than 27. No, sir.
Okay. Fine. Sir. How often?
3 weekly, sir.
Your voice is not clear.
Three weekly, sir. Is it clear,
or
sir?
4 weeks. That depends on the prevalence of the rheumatic fever. Is it a low risk case or a moderate or high risk case? Low risk case is defined as, there is a definition for it. That is less than 2 cases per 1 lakh children, school children. That is low risk. our rheumatic heart disease in the whole population is less than 1 in 1,000. That is low risk, where it is 1 in 4 weeks. Okay, how long will you give?
Depends on whether the patient had arthritis.
You tell me very clear. Okay. It
depends on whether the patient had carditis or not.
How many groups are there?
Three groups, basically.
Tell me the three groups.
If the patient did not have carditis,
his voice is not clear. There is some problem. So I'll tell you the Indian, you are quoting Indian or ACC/AHA?
The WHO one, sir.
Asked you, are you quoting Indian or ACC/AHA?
ACC/AHA, sir.
Indian and WHO are the same. Okay. Indian and WHO are the same. Oh, tell me, what is that? For patients with established heart disease. Heart disease.
At least
how long?
At least for 10 years or?
40 years. Or maybe even longer in high-risk cases. Patients with carditis. No significant residual heart disease. How long?
For 25 years of age.
25 years or?
For
minimum? 10 years.
No, sir.
No carditis.
10 years or 20, whichever is longer.
Okay. Minimum. No carditis. Yes.
No carditis, 5 years or 15 years, whichever is longer. Sir.
Which one?
Whichever is longer, for 5 years or 18 years, whichever.
Which up to what age?
18 years, sir. 18 years.
18 years. 18 years. So that is the Indian and WHO. Okay, you should know that. Because even though rheumatic fever has come down with valvular disease, they invariably ask questions on rheumatic fever prophylaxis. Now coming to the symptoms, it has been beautifully discussed by Dr. Kamal. So my approach will be, when you get palpitation, first step, is it an arrhythmic palpitation or a non-arrhythmic palpitation? So obviously this is a non-arrhythmic palpitation. So you should ask for, as a missed date, you should ask for paroxysmal palpitation, episodic palpitation. Yes. Second thing, along with palpitation, you have asked only for dyspnea, but you should ask for angina during palpitation, graying of vision, extreme fatigue, and following palpitation or during palpitation, polyuria. Okay, because you know, polyuria occurs during palpitation. You know that?
Yes, sir.
In which palpitation or arrhythmia it is more common?
Because of secretion of ENT, sir.
Not very clear. Some problem with your audio. In which arrhythmia palpitation is associated or arrhythmia is associated?
In arrhythmogenic palpitation, yes, because of secretion of ENT.
Is it with sinus tachycardia? Is it with atrial fibrillation? Is it VT? Is it AVNRT? Is it AVRT? PJRT. Okay, it is classically described with AVRT. And the mechanism you read, okay, AVRT, where there is Cannon wave or that is during the tachycardia, the P falls on the QRST during systole, there is a phasic expansion of the atrium or intermittent elevation of that goes up. That stimulates the release of the hormones and all those things. Okay, there is a next slide. Okay, now you come with the dyspnea, which is the most important thing. You have said he is able to carry out daily activities, lower level of activity. That is not enough. When you are describing, either you can say class 2, class 3, or the description should favor that. When you are seeing lower level of activity, if you go by the standard, they're not the NYHA, the other types of classification, they are describing which are the activities which are applicable to the Western population, like grocery, jogging, or we are not doing that. So what you have to do is, initially he was able to carry out his daily routine activities without symptoms. So what was his function class at that time?
Initially it was class 2.
At
sir.
That time, carry out his routine daily activities initially. What was the function class?
Without any exertion, he used to carry out his
My question is, he was able to carry out his daily activities initially.
In class 2, sir.
No, class 2, what is it? The patient, what is class 2?
The symptoms occur at, if the symptom occurs at rest, that's class 4.
What is class 2? NYHA class 2.
At ordinary activities.
Routine activities. and slight limitation of the activity. Here you are telling that he was able to carry out his routine daily activities initially. That is what we are doing. So you can't say that. For the last 2 years, his symptoms have increased at a lower level of activity. That is not enough. What you have to do is tell some examples. For example, initially, he was a person who was walking, was jogging or climbing this much of stairs, found that he was not able to do that. He was getting symptoms on walking 1 kilometer or climbing 2 flights of stairs like that. He was in class 2. His symptom remained like that till 2 years. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
He remained like that for the last, 10 years history, 8 years he was in class 2, and then 2 years he progressed. Am I right?
Yes, sir. Initially 8 years he is in class 2, sir.
His symptom of dyspnea started at 10 years.
Yes, 10 years.
So worsening occurred for the last 2 years. You cannot say at lower level of activity. Yes. We have to express either his activity like this thing, or you have to say, sir, for the last 2 years, his symptoms have increased for present to NYHA class 3. I will accept at postgraduate level. Okay. Then at that point, you have to finish dyspnea and you have to finish each symptom and then take the other symptom rather than mixing up the symptoms. Okay, you may have another symptom in between. You can take up that later. So dyspnea occurred and he is getting episodes of nocturnal dyspnea rather than telling at postgraduate level he gets dyspnea at rest night, he has to wake up, all those things. So for the last 2 months, he had 3 episodes of dyspnea during night, suggestive of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, because I don't want to spend time with the postgraduate on PND because we have so many other things to ask. So that is the way you have to finish the PND. That is the dyspnea. That is the symptom of dyspnea started 10 years back. Initially, it was on routine activities. He was in function class 2. He remained in class 2 for the last 10 years. And for the last 2 years, his symptom progressed to class 3. That is, he was getting symptoms on doing very minor activities like taking bath like that. And for the last 2 months, he had 3 episodes of dyspnea during night, suggestive paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. That will be better. This was not associated with hemoptysis. That also you have to say. Okay. So you finished palpitation. Next slide.
So the palpitation now has also started at rest.
Palpitation is the same. That it was initially on exertion. It was fast, regular, brought on by exertion, and it was relieved by rest. It was associated with dyspnea, but no syncope, angina, or extreme fatigue. There is no history of polyuria during the palpitation. There is no history of paroxysmal palpitation. Okay. That is about palpitation. Okay. The next slide. Next slide. Okay, that's fine. Now, this you have to say. Sudden onset of weakness with facial deviation to which side you have to say. Now, at that point, which resolved its own within an hour. Even though you are a cardiologist, we should know the basics in neurology. Especially when a patient comes to you on
connected.
This is a cerebrovascular event. What is the diagnosis? It is a TIA.
Yes.
Which side it is affected, tertiary which is affected, you should know. So he 2 years back, he had an episode of sudden onset of weakness of left half of body with facial deviation to the left or right, weakness of the left with facial deviation to the left. Okay. And which completely resolved in 1 hour. Sir, suggest you have TMA or right middle cerebral artery tertiary. You can conclude like that. I will give you extra marks for that because I don't want to spend much time on that. But our importance in this is in a patient who has a valvular heart disease, he may be on anticoagulation, or a heart disease patient may be on dual antiplatelet. We would like to know whether it is an occlusive stroke or a hemorrhagic stroke. Then sir was asking about coarctation and subarachnoid. That is aneurysm bleed. Okay, aortoarthritis with occlusive strokes. So all these things can have either occlusive stroke or hemorrhagic stroke. So it is our duty as a cardiologist in the casualty to know whether which tertiary is involved. And because you have so many things coming, a stroke, what is the role of anticoagulation, how to start, what is the modification, increasing the dosage, all those things are coming. We should read about that. Then don't say that he was started on a medical center and started on blood thinner. You don't say that blood thinner. These are local, this thing. You have used aspirin, you have used Penidur, all those things. Obviously, this MA person who has given, as our sir was not happy, You in detail describe about the joins which occurred about years back. So you, I am sure he will definitely tell what is this. So he was put on. What we want to know is whether he was put on oral anticoagulant or dual antiplatelet or single antiplatelet. Blood thinner doesn't convey anything. So you can ask him. Even an illiterate person, you can ask him what is the price of that drug. If it is 50 rupees, it is a novel anticoagulant. Is he checking INR regularly? It is vitamin K antagonist. So even with illiterate, we can get an idea. Oh, don't use the term blood thinner. So he was evaluated in detail and he was put on oral anticoagulant, vitamin K antagonist or novel anticoagulant, which I'm sure that MA teacher will definitely tell you the list of the drugs. Okay. So the dyspnea, I said, you have to put it with the, and he was prescribed medicine that increased his urine output, not needed. He was put on medications which included anticoagulant or an antiplatelet and diuresis possibly. You know any other drug which can increase the urine output? The classical, the old drug where it was given and it was found to be a diuretic. Digoxin. Digoxin actually, when the edema disappeared, they thought it was a diuretic initially. So don't put like that. You will get so many questions. Which are the drugs which increase the urine output other than diuretic? So come to the postgraduate level. They're a little brief, better sentences. And we don't translate what the patient or bystander has given. We grab the information and put it in a reasonable medical without using the real diagnosis. Next slide, please. I'll take 2-3 minutes more. Next slide.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Next. Then you have gone through that. Fine. Okay, fine. Family history, I want. Okay, don't say married with 2 children. Okay, I'm not happy with that statement, married with 2. He is married, he has 2 children. Okay, next slide. Family history, you have not, no similar, previous one. Similar illness in any family members. Now, what is the relevance of that? Especially when sir was asking about other conditions. So sir was discussing about different diagnosis other than a rheumatic valvular heart disease. Even in rheumatic heart disease, we have to ask for the history of rheumatic fever in childhood, in siblings, not the family members, others. Then obviously, if his siblings have rheumatic heart disease, they had rheumatic fever. And they will ask you about the family history, HLA, all those things about rheumatic. You should read about rheumatic fever in depth. Okay. Then sir was asking, so there are certain diseases which can run in families, can present with heart failure or heart diseases, which can mimic mitral valve disease. Okay, that's fine about the history. And I'll take a break and Dr. Kamal or Dr. Sumod or whoever it is can take their decision. Then I would like to discuss how we will approach that history. Dr. Kamal Saab?
Yes, sir. So sir has given you an extensive review of how the history should ideally be presented, sir. Fantastic, sir. You have started right from the first slide and you have given it. So adding on to some of the questions that sir has mentioned, what about, how do you give a penicillin test dose? How much is the amount of units that is given? Do you need to do test? How do you give?
For the penicillin test dose, we take around 0.1 ml and double dilute it.
No, that's not 0.1 ml. That's 0.1 ml of diluted in 20 cc versus diluted in 1 cc will be very different. You have to speak in units.
The total dose is 5,000 to 8,000 units, sir.
5,000 to 8,000, correct. 8,000. So how do you calculate that? You mentioned it, double dilution.
Double dilution.
Right. What are the rheumatogenic strains? Rheumatogenic strains? Okay. What is the organism causing rheumatic fever?
Group A beta
hemolytic streptococcus. Now, again, group A beta hemolytic streptococcus also causes what? One more disorder? Which other disorder?
Shall I give a clue for that?
Pyoderma and
impetigo. What does it lead to? Which renal?
Renal PSG. I mean.
Yeah, post-streptococcal nephritis. You don't give penicillin prophylaxis there, right? Both have same organism. Both have not a direct effect. It's all a, you know, far off, far-fetching effects, both in the synovium and the heart and the kidney. Why do you go and give a repeat prophylaxis or a prolonged prophylaxis? Why there are no recurrences in PSGM? Once done, and then that's the end of the story. Why?
Because it has immune complex mediated.
Yeah, so immune complex, already there are antibodies. Again, the second infection, and you can have another immune complex going and then getting deposited in PSGN. It doesn't happen that way. Why? What about, why does the impetigo or skin infection doesn't cause rheumatic fever? Why it's only the upper airway that the infection should come through and then only you'll get rheumatic fever? Why it doesn't come through the skin?
So there are these serotypes this has been described as a molecular mimicry mechanism.
No, that's why I'm asking. Molecular mimicry, does it happen only through sore throat? Why should it not happen through skin infection? It can happen through skin also, no? Why it doesn't happen? Something happens there. So these are some questions. Why as sir was asking, Sudhir Kumar sir, I asked you very clearly, why 21 days?
Yes,
why not 18 days?
Because the tissue concentration of, this has been studied as 3 weeks versus 4 weeks, as well as 2 weeks versus 2 weeks versus.
So there are three, four reasons. One is Liu et al.'s data, which has compared Dr. Padmavati's series, which has again compared 1.2, 1.8 weekly, 21 days versus monthly. And then all the incubation period is how much? 2 to 3 weeks, right? So that's when it ends. So the next infection, it comes, then you'll have to cover 3 weeks. That's the phase that's gone. And then, of course, tissue concentration, which is measured by urinary penicillin level. Yeah, which disappears. Tissue concentration of penicillin disappears at 19 to 21 days. That's why you give every 21 days. Fine. Now, why oral penicillins? Which of the two is better, IM or oral?
Actually, there have been four studies comparing the international.
Which one is better?
IM is better with
less. IM, yeah, intramuscular is better. How? What is the recurrence rate?
0.29 per 100 patient years for IM, and for oral, I think it's 5.8 per 100.
Yeah, more than 10 times. Correct. So why is this so much of difference? On one end, you are giving it daily, twice a day, and then the other one, you're just depositing it in the gluteal region, in the fat and tissue.
Because it's slow release from this.
No. Is it the serum level that is important, or it's something else?
The tissue
what happens to oral penicillin? Is the penicillin absorption from oral tract uniform?
Because in the tissue level, the tissue concentration.
But I've given you a clue. Is the oral penicillin absorption uniform from oral tract? Are all penicillins given orally, or you have some specific salts to be given orally?
No, sir.
What are the oral salts of penicillin? So see, all these questions are very basic and primitive questions, which, I mean, it's like hernia of cardiology. You know, in surgery, you get a case of long AS. They say in MBBS, you get hernia, means you should know everything. Same in cardiology, rheumatic fever, there is no credit of knowing these. If you don't know, then there's always a discredit. So somebody can, you know, pull it on you, all these kind of basic nuances. How much penicillin you'll give? What gauge of needle is used to give penicillin?
18 gauge.
Why? Ideally, you should ask me, sir, what? The test dose or the intramuscular? Test dose, you'll not require 18 gauge. Yes, the test, when you give test dose, what do you see? What do you see for the test dose?
Skin reaction.
Yeah? You see or you feel?
The induration and the skin reaction.
So you feel. You don't just see, you feel. Feel for induration, correct?
Induration.
So yeah. How long you'll have to wait? Or do you have to give test dose every time? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you have to test every time, right? So what are the things that suppose, what kind of reactions are known with penicillin? What type of hypersensitivity is it? One, two, three.
Anaphylactic reaction is known to be with.
Is that the only thing? Only anaphylaxis, or you can get some other kind of penicillin related side effects? Can it cause SJ syndrome?
Yes, sir.
Can penicillin con Steven Johnson? So yeah, these questions are, I know, I mean, I'm getting too much into penicillins, but see, examiner, if I hope I have never, and I'll never be asking you this if I was your examiner, but if you know somebody of this temperament gets into your exam, he can just keep on asking until he doesn't know penicillin, how can I give you DM cardiology? So you should just be prepared. That's all. I'm just, it's better to, you know, prepare you. The point is not to drag your feet over here. You're doing well. The idea is that these small things, so right from starting such things, you can be asked the other extreme of it. What is eagle effect? What is eagle effect? Abhishek, am I audible? Yeah, what is eagle effect?
To the candidate during teaching session, if you are not sure, just answer.
I'm not aware.
We can save time and sir will teach you. That will be better in a teaching session.
I'm not aware.
Eagle effect and co-pathogen effect. These are two effects which are described in Stollerman's textbook of acute rheumatic fever. Nobody reads it now, but there are these questions are also now there in the textbook of Jagat Narula as well. And there, these both effects are, one is eagle effect, other is co-pathogen effect. Co-pathogen effect is the commensals in the throat can produce penicillinase and will make penicillin ineffective. And that's how they prevent the development. I mean, they are not effective. This penicillin can still give rise to recurrences. So most of the series is from the Stollerman and Fenstein actually looked into these aspects. What is chronic rheumatic fever? Have you heard of chronic rheumatic fever? So these are some of the rare questions that sometimes you can examiner is just hellbent on asking rheumatic fever. So I thought because sir had started this discussion, I thought let's take today rheumatic fever per se. So I went on talking. Chronic rheumatic fever is defined again by Feinstein, who talked about 265 days or something, exact number I'm forgetting, but it's 200 plus days of chronic rheumatic activity documented by inflammatory markers. If it's persistently elevated, they termed it as chronic rheumatic fever, but again, it's a questionable entity. But Feinstein had coined this, and it's something that you just should be aware of. What is the status of penicillin rheumatic fever vaccine? If you can develop a COVID vaccine, why not a penicillin, why not a rheumatic fever vaccine? What's the problem? Again, the answer lies why you need to give prophylaxis for rheumatic fever again and again, but not for the nephrotic syndrome, for the PSGN, because the immunity is strain specific. You don't end up, because there are multiple strains, right? There are 10 strains that have been called as rheumatogenic strain, starting from strain number 1 to some 55. So these strains, you can have one time one coming in, then the next time you have 3, and then you have 55. So immune response is usually transient. And the molecular mimicry, of course, doesn't help you much, because whatever, if you try to create an immune response which is type specific for a Lancefield class A, the immune response would cross react and will not be protective and actually can cause molecular mimicry and harm. So that's why vaccines are not so effective, just like HIV. We are still lagging in it. So if you have just one marker that you can cross react and pick it up, then it's easier for the M spike protein. But that doesn't work. And that's why vaccines have not been able to prevent rheumatic fever. They can generate immunogenic response, but they don't protect against rheumatic fever. That's why the effectiveness is not there. All right. So from this history, you think, so other things that you saw is RB, EMF, constriction, mild constriction can present with like this, restrictive cardiomyopathy, aortoarthritis, coarctation, bicuspid aortic valve. Can this be ASD? So whenever you ask differential, you think of all the things, valvular, congenital, disorders can extend from all the chapters, you know, whatever can fit into the same. Again, things that are going against is the duration, 10 to 12 years, like RC, RVEMF, etc. will not have such a benign, long course. Usually, they are more malignant. The history will not run into decades. It would be much shorter for the progression from the class 2 to 3. Sudhay Kumar sir would be the right person to talk about EMF rather than me, sir.
Okay, fine. It's a wonderful learning session, Dr. Kamal. You seem to be an authority in rheumatic fever.
No, sir.
Sir, I learned a lot, especially that penicillin, no, sir, no, sir. All those things, penicillin and test dose, all those things, really wonderful, which I have finding it difficult to recollect because rheumatic fever is extremely uncommon now. and we are not giving penicillin. Really, really enjoyed that discussion.
Thank you, sir.
Now I come back to our friend. Now coming to that discussion, how to approach this? One, basically you have to ask, is it only a symptom or does he have a disease? Yes, he has a disease. Then which system is affected? It's simple, it is the cardiovascular system. Then based on the symptoms, you have to look into what is the altered physiology and try to localize it. Localize it to left heart, right heart, or both. Once you have localized it based on the physiology, anatomical localization, like sir has said, is it a valve, is it the myocardium, is it the pericardium, like that. Then you have to look what are the severe, what is the severity of the problem, the complications, etiology, planned management. Like that, I approach this case. So which symptom would you like to discuss, Dr. Abhishek? You have two, three sets of symptoms. Which would you like to discuss? You are given the freedom.
Yes, sir. He had, initially he had palpitation for...
No. Don't repeat. Uh-huh. Now, when you are discussing, what I usually teach the postgraduates is, you have to put it into clusters. For example, history of polyarthritis at the age of 14 years. Then the symptom complex is palpitation and dyspnea for the last 12 years. And a neurological problem about 2 years back. So these are the three sets of symptoms he's having. So you have to start like that. Then it is easy for us. We will not miss.
So the rheumatic fever at the first episode of acute rheumatic fever.
So there is one thing which we have discussed. We had a lengthy discussion on that thing. But the important thing is, it is not the discussion. You should read some of these standard articles or what is called important masterpieces in rheumatic fever, which is quite early. You might not have been reading. But you should not forget to read the latest also. For example, the latest ACC-AHA of 2015 and that of the, again, ACC-AHA of the latest, the revision of some caption where very clearly given, all these things are given. Not the Penidior, all those things are not given. You should read that. But I would like to discuss the dyspnea. How will you approach that? Which would you think is the more important symptom? Is the palpitation or the dyspnea? Which you think you are comfortable to discuss? Or we would like to discuss this to make the diagnosis. Which symptom you would like to take to arrive at the diagnosis? Is it the palpitation or dyspnea? Because palpitation is a very, very vague symptom. Any person coming to the cardiology OP, if you ask, they are having exertional palpitation. So many times it is a non-specific symptom. And sir has discussed how to approach it, arrhythmic, increase the thud or change in the force of contraction. Also. Now dyspnea, how will you approach? So what do you think the altered physiology for the dyspnea? For palpitation, we said it could be rhythm problem. It could be increased rate. It could be force of contraction like that. So what is the likely mechanism of dyspnea? In this case, the physiological mechanism. What is the altered physiology which is producing the dyspnea? Comes to cardiovascular physiology. So his symptom of dyspnea indicate that this hemodynamic factor is abnormal. What is that?
Likely because of the stenotic lesion.
No, I asked you physiological, not anatomical. The what physiology? The valvular lesion has produced this abnormal physiology, the cardiovascular physiology, mainly it is cardiac output, pulmonary venous congestion, systemic venous congestion, pulmonary arterial hypertension. These are the basic. You can talk about the vascular resistance when you come to working up the case. But basically, what is his cardiac output? What is his venous pressures? What is his pulmonary artery pressures? And obviously, desaturation. These are things which you have to look for. So among this, which you think is responsible for his symptom of dyspnea? Low cardiac output can produce dyspnea. Desaturation can produce dyspnea. Pulmonary hypertension can produce dyspnea because of multiple mechanisms. Pulmonary venous hypertension can produce dyspnea. So what do you think is likely physiological explanation for this dyspnea? Which is likely?
Most likely because of the raised pulmonary venous pressure.
Yes. So this patient has features of pulmonary venous hypertension. Why do you say that? Why not the other things? Cyanotic children will have exertional dyspnea because with the exercise, the oxygen saturation cannot increase, the fatigue, acidosis, all those things.
The most important cleanser is the history, the new history of PND.
Yes. Sir, yes, a progressive dyspnea class 3 with episodes of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, which is, I will take it as pulmonary venous hypertension. Is it mild, moderate or severe now?
It is severe now, sir.
What is the likely pulmonary capillary pressure or venous pressure?
ECWP will be more than, for severe PVS, would be more than 25, sir.
More than 25 millimeters of mercury. So he is it an acute disease or a chronic disease?
This is a, it is a chronic one.
Is it a static or a progressive disease?
It's a progressive disease.
So what you can conclude is, there's patient having progressive dyspnea landing a paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea indicate a chronic progressive pulmonary venous congestion. Now it is severe. Okay.
Yes.
So pulmonary venous congestion for practical purpose indicate which chamber pressure is elevated.
Sorry, sir.
Which cardiac chamber pressure is elevated?
Elite pressure is in.
Pardon?
Elite pressure is in raised.
No, don't use short form because I am confused.
Sorry.
I'm not clear. What is your answer?
The left atrial pressure.
Left atrial pressure. I heard it as LV. That is why I don't know what you have said. Left atrial pressure is elevated. What are the situation? Two groups of situation where left atrial pressure is elevated. One, there is an LV inflow obstruction. Second, LV diastolic pressure is elevated. If there is LV inflow obstruction, the LV pressure will be elevated with normal LV diastolic pressure. If the LV inflow obstruction is not there, for simple purpose, we use the term mitral stenosis, but postgraduate should use the term LV inflow obstruction. When you're talking about the physiology and diagnosis before the anatomical location. So LV inflow obstruction, if there is no LV inflow obstruction, LA pressure elevation indicates elevation of the LV diastolic pressure. So there comes the question which sir has asked, what are the conditions other than mitral stenosis or LV inflow obstruction, which can produce LV diastolic pressure elevation? Is it a hypertensive problem? Is it a valvular problem? Is it a myocardial problem? Is it a pericardial problem? Or rarely rhythm problem? Forget about the rhythm problem now. Tachycardiomyopathies. So we will come. If it is not mitral valve disease, what it could be? Is it aortic valve disease? Now you have to discuss, is it aortic valve disease? Is it aortic stenosis, aortic regurgitation? Are there any points? There are no history to suggest aortic stenosis. Because by the time they come with a class 4 symptom, they will have so many other symptoms. Is it aortic regurgitation? You can discuss. Is it typical or atypical? If it is not myocardial disease, is it an acute myocardial disease or a chronic myocardial disease? If it is a chronic myocardial disease, is it ischemic? Is it inflammatory? Is it idiopathic or iatrogenic? Four eyes you have to look into. Okay. A 33-year-old man without ischemic background, no risk factors, no history of angina, it is less likely, and 10 years history of breathlessness, it is less likely to be ischemic. So you are dealing with a chronic non-ischemic myocardial disease. So which are the non-ischemic myocardial disease of this much duration which can present just like mitral valve disease? Cardiomyopathies, restrictive cardiomyopathy is the one which mimics mitral valve disease, which include different types. As sir said, if it is in south, we may think of endomyocardial fibrosis. But that is very uncommon nowadays in Kerala. But still it is rampant in some of the southern states. So when you talk about EMF, you said there is no right heart. That depends on which side is predominantly affected. Is it predominantly left heart, predominantly right heart, or biventricular? Actually, the original series from Chitra, everything, and even the literature from Africa, all those things, left ventricular was equally dominant. So if it is a left ventricular dominant endomyocardial fibrosis, it mimics a restrictive left heart disease, myocardial disease, and it mimics mitral valve disease. So if I am asked to discuss what are the possibilities, because there is definite history of rheumatic, if you are diagnosed, valvular heart disease. Valvular heart disease which presents with a left atrial hypertension, the valve which is close to the left atrium is mitral valve, which is much, much more common in rheumatic. So I think in terms of mitral valve disease. Aortic valve disease, less likely because of so many things which you know. That in the absence, I said, if there is no history of rheumatic fever, I think of again this thing, valvular heart disease. Non-rheumatic valvular disease, you have put it as mitral valve collapse. Marfan syndrome presenting like that. Or among the chronic myocardial diseases, you think in terms of restrictive cardiomyopathy. Can it be hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? Yes, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy also presents with symptom of mild exertional breathlessness initially. We are not talking about the classical hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. A sizable number doesn't have obstruction, which they present with classically diastolic dysfunction. And later they progress to systolic dysfunction. They progress to heart failure, class 3, class 4 symptom because of multiple reasons. So it could be, but much lower in the list compared to other cardiomyopathies. Dilated cardiomyopathy also presents, but long history is unlikely to be dilated cardiomyopathy. Dilated cardiomyopathy usually have a relatively short history. So if I am asked, first, obviously, in this case, it is valvular heart disease, mitral valve disease, which can explain almost the whole thing. If it is not mitral valve disease, I go for a myocardial, non-ischemic myocardial disease, chronic nature, of which I will put restrictive cardiomyopathy ahead of the others. Then the question will be, what else? As sir said, can it be congenital pericarditis? These are the questions that will be, can it be congenital pericarditis? Less likely, because congenital pericarditis, it's a uniform constriction. Systemic and pulmonary venous pressure elevation will be almost the same tune. So PND is very unlikely, it can occur rarely. Systemic venous congestion is the dominant thing. The cardiac output is usually preserved, so they present with more of systemic venous congestion with probably class 2 symptom of dyspnea. So that you can put low in the list. Then sir asked, can it be ASD? What is your answer for that? Sir, ASD, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea is less likely. Okay, but sometimes as age advances in the older people, they can have biventricular dysfunction and they can have severe symptom of dyspnea. You can say the age of onset is symptom is at 14 years or 12 years history. Male less common like that. What we want is, what is the usual manifestation of AD? You have to say it is more common in female. They present with heart failure in the fourth and fifth decade. Here the patient started symptom at the age of 25 or 26. And PND orthopnea is very unlikely. By the time there are PND and orthopnea, they will be having systemic venous congestion and they will have atrial fibrillation. So like that you can explain. Like that you can search certain different diagnosis. This is what I have to tell you about how to approach the symptom. You need not go into the detail. Dyspnea, class 2 to class 3 with PND, pulmonary venous congestion severe. It's a chronic progressive indicating a left heart disease. Indicate the left atrial pressure is elevated. Sir, this could be with LV inflow obstruction or secondary to elevated LV diastolic pressure. Then you tell some causes. Okay, Dr. Kamal.
Yes, sir. I think we should move to examination. We are already one hour into discussion of his history.
Okay, fine.
Then we can
listen. Yeah, go to examination.
Yes,
sir. Dr. Abhishek.
Yes, sir. Then the clinical examination, the patient is conscious alert and related to the patient.
Your audio is not clear. That is a
problem. Yes.
Hello. Is it clear, sir?
Yeah.
It's conscious oriented and oriented to time present person. The weight is 62 kg, height of 170 cm.
So absent AVA, what are the causes for this patient that you suspect? JVP.
Sorry, sir?
JVP?
Yes, sir. The patient had atrial fibrillation, sir.
Once. Any other cause that you know that can happen? Not in this patient, but otherwise you have absent AVAs. Anything other than AFib? Not just AVAV, there is no wave. So there is no A wave. Non-pulsatile JVP. Causes?
Cardiac, non-cardiac?
Non-pulsatile, sorry.
Sorry?
Non-pulsatile JVP.
No, I'm saying, so non-pulsatile cardiac, non-cardiac, sir, is asking, what are the causes of absent A wave? Means absent JVP pulsation. I'm saying you can have absent all pulses. That also can happen. No, all waves can be
like
absent.
Like in obstruction, sir, like in SVC obstruction or in...
Okay, SVC obstruction, 1 second.
Cardiac following surgery.
In SVC obstruction or SVC syndrome with compression. Morbidly obese.
SVC is not connecting to RA. It is not transmitting the RA pulsations.
Sir has mentioned that one surgery where the SVC is not into the RA. Uh-huh. Tell me any surgery where SVC is not connected to RA.
The Glenn circuit, sir.
So circuit is Fontan. Glenn is one type of surgery of it. Yes. Correct. So Fontan circuit. Correct. Fontan. Then? Okay. Go ahead.
Dr. Kamal, I would like to know.
Yes, sir.
What we usually tell is pulse, blood pressure, then only we usually come to JVP.
Yes,
here,
sir.
He is going straight to JVP.
Yeah.
The problem is, when you deviate from, I don't know what is the standard in your institute, whatever examination I have attended, it is pulse, blood pressure, respiration, systemic oxygen saturation, which is taken, temperature, and then comes to JVP. Now, the moment you come to JVP, you will be taken for a ride on JVP and try to get away from JVP at the earliest. Okay. I'm extremely happy to discuss JVP, ask you. If it is in person, I will ask you to draw the JVP of so many conditions. So pulse, blood, that is the way we have been teaching, and many of the examiners want that. Okay. It's not clear to me in the audio. I don't know whether it is my fault or not.
The pulse is 8. Is it clear, sir? Hello, is it clear, sir?
So what are the blood pressure indices, modern indices that can predict cardiovascular activity or functional status? How can blood pressure help you in assessing severity of various valvular heart disease? Am I audible, Dr. Abhishek?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So suppose patient is having severe AS, what will the thing that you would like to see, or severe MS, or for that matter, any patient with LV dysfunction in a patient of, say, AR and MR.
The pulse pressure, do you ask me the pulse pressure, sir?
So one is proportional pulse pressure, proportional correct. Pressure. That is one. Second?
Cardiac index.
Okay, go ahead.
Whatever you get it, sir.
Can just tell, because I will take what will be the blood pressure in the various pulse valvular heart disease. That's simple. The other thing you can say, proportionate, disproportionate is a white pulse pressure, systolic pressure elevation, diastolic pressure lower down, or both abnormal, narrow pulse pressure. Okay. But you tell me what will be the blood pressure in mitral stenosis severe, mitral regurgitation severe. Okay, you learn that later. Go ahead.
The blood pressure is 106 by 60 millimeters of mercury in right upper limb, 108 by 62 millimeters of mercury in left upper limb, and 122 by 62 millimeters of mercury in right lower limb.
Dr. Abhishek, we can't hear you. I mean, your audio is a bit...
Take care of your voice here, please. This is so much important.
You have the mic close to your mouth, please. If you're wearing the earphones, then keep the mic close to your mouth, or you can speak if you're speaking through laptop closer to the.
Yes, sir.
We can't hear you. Yeah.
Blood pressure is 106 by 60 millimeters of mercury, right? Upperly, 108 by 60.
Yeah, go ahead. Beyond the blood pressure, sir has already given you multiple clues. He has mentioned about white pulse pressure, say Hills. If I was to ask you the other way around, you will start answering quickly. So, simple question was you look at Hills, you look at white pulse pressure, you look at pulse proportional pulse pressure, you look at systolic decapitation of aortic stenosis, you look for a narrow pulse pressure in mitral stenosis. You look at narrow pulse pressure in aortic stenosis. You compare and look at the diastolic values in AR. You look at the MR, the systolic. What is the what happens in MR? Severity of MR?
With the blood pressure, the...
How is collapsing pulse of MR different from an AR?
There is a runoff, sir.
Okay. Go ahead. Go ahead. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Correct.
Yeah. The chest is bilaterally symmetrical. The apical impulse is shifting down and out.
I think you have to keep your microphone very close to your mouth.
The apical impulse is shifted. Is it clear? The apical impulse is shifted down and out, 3 cm lateral to the mid-lateral line. Apex is localized. Directed pulsation can be seen. No other visible pulsation. Spine is normal. On palpation, the inspection findings were confirmed. Apical impulse is in 17th intercostal space. 3 centimeters lateral to the mid-clavicular line. A para-external heave of grade 3 was present. The diastolic heave was present. There is no epigastric pulsation. On percussion, the left heart border corresponded to the apex and the right heart border was substandard. Second intercostal space was resonant and a liver dullness started from the right fifth intercostal space with a span of 12 centimeters. Coming to the auscultation,
Before coming to the auscultation, what I usually teach is, auscultation is, I am going to look for these things. I am expecting these things. I want to fine tune my auscultation to pick up additional things. That information you should get before auscultation. Shall I take 2 minutes? Okay. Can I go back
to
the previous slides? And for postgraduates, in majority of the centers, we usually combine inspection and palpation. We don't put this inspection, palpation, percussion like that. If I am asked, we combine it. Sir, the chest is previous one. I will say the chest is symmetric. There is no precordial prominence. There are prominent suprasternal pulsations. These visible things I'll tell, and few negative things like no scar, all those things. What usually we talk is apex beat is seen and felt. That is the way we have been teaching, and some of the examiners are doing that because we are combining it. By inspection, you can't make out, especially in obese patients, females, all those things. So apex beat is seen and felt in the seventh left intercostal space, 3 centimeters lateral to the midclavicular line. Next slide.
Yes, sir.
And the character you have to tell. That is an important thing. You will be screwed on that. And what is the character of the apex beat? And we'll ask you, is it LV type or RV type? What is the cause? Why do you say it is LV type or RV type? Why I'm giving these questions is because we are running short of time. You have to take this up with your examiners and teachers and learn how it is. If you know, fine, but those questions will come. Then grade 3 parastinal heave is there. And diastolic thrill, you have to see where is the diastolic thrill. That is very important. You have to tell where is the diastolic thrill. Okay, you cannot say diastolic thrill.
Okay.
So when you are palpating, you have to see where is the apex beat. The aim is, when you have diagnosed atrial fibrillation, so rhythm is okay, with controlled ventricular response. Second, there is cardiomegaly. Is it LV volume overload, LV pressure load, RV volume overload, RV pressure load, or biventricular? That information you have to make. What is the pulmonary artery like and what is the PA pressure? Looking at a dilated dynamic pulmonary artery with palpable second sound. Is the suprasternal pulsation prominent to suggest a cardiac output, which is very unlikely in this case because the blood pressure is on the normal side. So at the end of your examination, he is in atrial fibrillation with a controlled ventricular rate. JVP was not elevated. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
So he is not in systemic venous congestion or right heart failure. There is cardiomegaly, LV, RV, or biventricular.
It's cardiomegaly.
It is LV definitely, with the parastinal wave indicates right ventricle. Is the LV volume load, pressure load?
Volume load.
Is it volume load or pressure load?
Volume overload.
Volume overload is down and out and probably forcible. So when you are talking about valvular heart disease, with a large left ventricular volume overload, with a narrow pulse pressure, obviously it is mitral regurgitation. So we know that this patient has mitral regurgitation. This patient doesn't have significant AS or AR. I mean significant. So our aim is to see whether there is associated mitral stenosis. It is obvious because you have got a diastolic thrill. Diastolic thrill is very unlikely in a USA, this average built in all those things with the functional murmurs. So with your findings, we're almost sure that he has a mixed mitral disease with pulmonary hypertension, atrial fibrillation. So what are the things you have to look for? JVP, is there a prominent VV? Because this much of heart with atrial fibrillation, they are likely to have TR. So you have to look, concentrate for a TR. And when you are auscultation, look for aortic events, look for TR also. So that is the way we have to tune the auscultation. Because we have to anticipate, this I am expecting. This may be there. This I have to look carefully. Then everything will be okay. So you should know what are they. So JVP, A wave, V wave is very important. Okay, go ahead. Dr. Kamal.
Yeah, so sir has already given you a hint as to what we are expecting in your auscultation. You should remember that at least the examiner is always hellbent on contradicting you. You should not contradict yourself. Your findings should match at least in whatever you are speaking in percussion, auscultation. So for example, your second space is resonant, you mentioned. Now, with second space dull is anticipated in a patient who's got a severe MR or has got a PAH or has got a pericardial effusion. Now, if you're going to speak of a severe MR, which is of chronic in nature, LA has to get dilated and appendage has to come into the second left intercostal space. So let's hear first your auscultation and then we'll discuss that. Go ahead, please.
First heart sound is soft, variable. And the second heart sound is narrowly split, normal A2. Normal A2 and a loud P2 with no S3 and S4. A loud opening snap is based on that middle to the apex with a narrow H2.
Yeah, 1 minute, sir. As sir was mentioning, usually, again, some examiners are okay with sounds first and murmurs second, murmur, then the second heart sound, then the opening snap, and then the murmur again. So, either ways is okay, but it again depends, as because sir was mentioning that some examiners have different, like JVP. Coming after pulse BP and then confirming your hemodynamics correlation with the same. Same way, sometimes murmur may be expected to be spoken in the cardiac cycle variant. That's what usually you would anticipate in a cardiology case, but this is also fine as long as it's acceptable. Go ahead.
I could hear soft rumbling, low pitched, mid-dash, long mid-dash, diastolic murmur at the apex associated with it without any pre-systolic accentuation. Which is based on with the bell of the stethoscope in left lateral patient in the left lateral position with breath holding exclusion. The second murmur that you could hear here was a high pitched flowing early diastole murmur, which started just after A2 and occupying in early diastole less than 2/3 at the left third intercostal space with conduction in the up to the left lower external border. It is based on the patient in the sitting up and leaning forward position with diaphragm of the stethoscope. And increasing the end. The third was the blowing pansystolic murmur of grade 3 intensity, hard at the apex with radiation to the xylem, and it is based on with the diaphragm of the stethoscope and patient the left lateral position. And the fourth was grade 3 short medium pitched harsh crescendo ESM murmur of grade 3 intensity in the third intercostal space and ending before the onset of A2. It was based on with the diaphragm of the stethoscope with no radiation to the carotid or no radiation to apex.
Again, with the grading of the murmur, some examiners don't want you to grade diastolic murmurs, which is fine. But in certain cases, some people grade it up to grade 4 because sometimes the 3 may be there. So 5, 6 goes away in diastolic. And out of 4, you can still grade it. So you should just be prepared in case some examiner is interested and keen to, you know, why haven't you spoken the grade of diastolic murmur? You can say, sir, diastolics are usually not graded because beyond 4, it just means severe, nothing else. But in case somebody asks you, the modification that was proposed was to grade diastolic as 4 and systolic as 6 is something that you should know. So here you are saying that patient has got everything, right? MS, MR, ASAR, right? Is that what you're
saying? Yes, could be. I just one doubt that with the history, it could be typically a MS and MR case. But with the examination, there was an additional aortic sound, which is not correlated with the history. The patient did not give any history suggestive of aortic wall lesion. Definitely there was a murmur on the aortic area.
What is the name of the grading, anyway, of the murmurs? How do you grade them? What are the who coined them?
Grading of...
What are NADA's criteria? That's how the grading was important, NADA's criteria?
Yes, sir. For the congenital...
For congenital heart disease, right? That's where the grading came, no? Less than 3 and more than 3. That is the implication of the grading. Okay, any other sound? That's it, or you have something more? Again, an exam, because Suday Kumar sir has been so very meticulous about a lot of things. It's anticipated that you keep in your answer sheet the auscultogram drawn. So you should learn how to draw an auscultogram. the intensity of the sound is drawn in a bar with out of six. That's how it's classically described. The loudest being six, the softest being one, and usually normal is three. And that's how you draw the bar of the sounds. And then again, you draw the murmurs, and then you draw the second heart sound, and then you draw the diastolic cycle. So auscultogram is something that you should, if you've not drawn, nobody's going to come and catch hold of you, but it's something that can give you a credit. If somebody asks you to show your answer sheet, or you can be smart enough, displaying, holding your answer sheet with that auscultogram visible to the examiner, and the examiner kept catching it up. So if you're very well versed with how to draw an auscultogram, you should draw it in your answer sheets that are provided to you, especially in DNB exams, where answer sheets are valued much more as compared to the DM exams, where actually they go more with the viva rather than answer sheets, what is written being evaluated. DNB exams, they always evaluate the answer sheets that you submit along with your viva. So, yeah, go ahead. Again, anything else?
Yes, sir. The only thing was the murmur that I was not able to explain with the history of the
aortic. Okay. Right. Next. So, aortic system examination is normal. So there is no residual defect, as sir was saying. This is that episode was TIA. Right. Next. Next. Yeah. So let's discuss your diagnosis, doctor. Sir, you wanted to say something. Yes.
I want to take that auscultatory finding and make some comments how to modify that.
Yes, sir.
I wanted to one. Sir said there are two ways, but Dr. Kamal, I have many of the examiners prefer to finish the sounds first, then the murmurs. Then the second thing, I'll make some comments also. Don't feel bad, Abhishek. Now, once you take mitral, finish the mitral murmurs, then go to the aortic murmurs rather than mixing up. Now, which lesion has to be, you will start with mitral or aortic depends on which is the dominant lesion. For example, here, obviously, mitral valve is the dominant lesion. So I'll take mitral events followed by aortic events rather than mixing up. That will be a better way. Then coming to, I have a question which is in this A2 OS gap in AF. There is one question which you will ask. I will ask. Don't say loud opening snap. Because you got a loud opening snap with a soft S1, not a usual combination.
It's contradictory, It's contradictory. You cannot have.
Because when the S1 is soft, the valve is not closing properly. Very unlikely that you are hearing an opening snap, that to a loud opening snap. Are you thinking it is a opening snap or a third sound? That question invariably you have to face. Because here, based on the findings otherwise, MR seems to be predominant. Based on, so is it third sound or opening snap? That's a question that you have to, question you will face. You should answer that. I'm not asking because you should answer that. Yes. Then don't put this thrill at that time when you're auscultating, because you already put it a thrill. So in auscultation, thrill doesn't come. Okay, the rest of the things okay. Short, medium pitch. When you are talking aortic murmur, all examiners, including me, are very particular about the peaking of the murmur. You should talk about the thrill grade of the murmur, length of the murmur, and the peaking. Okay. Then dynamic auscultation you did only for one, and second, dynamic auscultation has limited role in atrial fibrillation. So you will end up in trouble with dynamic auscultation. And try to escape from dynamic auscultation in JVP and Valsalva at the earliest. These three things, you will be in trouble. Okay. So you have used the dynamic auscultation only for that. So this is a stimulus for us to ask questions on dynamic auscultation. And in AF, it is a difficult thing. I will put an exercise for you. That is the S2 OS interval in atrial fibrillation. You can, because somebody has to listen to you in person. If you are not clear, somebody has to teach you properly, because it is not easy in virtual platform to discuss or teach. That is very, very important. There's two OS gap and how to differentiate whether it was OS or third sound. These are important because it's extremely important in saying whether this is a dominant mitral stenosis or dominant mitral regurgitation. Okay, that is very important. The findings are favoring MR or favoring MS. It's obviously a mixed lesion. That's all what I have to tell about the findings, my comment about the findings. These are some of the warning for you. Okay. Yes, yes. Go ahead.
Should I move ahead?
Keep your microphone very close to the mouth always.
Should I move ahead, sir?
Yes.
Please come to your diagnosis and justify why for everything. So you're mentioning here 10 points, RHD, MS. So justify each of them. Why RHD? So that we have started. History of rheumatic fever, chronic nature, penicillin prophylaxis, history of migratory polyarthritis, and rheumatic. Why severe MS?
This is a long mid-diastolic.
So don't jump to long mid-diastolic directly. Yes, start
the
from...
Patient, yes, sir, the history-wise also, the patient gets...
Correct. So always start from NYHA class.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, JVP, atrial fibrillation. So atrial fibrillation, is it related to severity? Yes or no?
Duration as well as severity, sir.
So chronicity, it's not related to severity, it is related to chronicity. One more symptom which is related to chronicity, not severity, hemoptysis. Hemoptysis is again not related to severity, it's again related to chronicity. Any other, why it's severe MS?
With history of PND as well, sir.
So one PND short A2 OS interval. What do you expect severe MS to have, first heart sound to be?
The S1 should be loud, but with
yeah, always of, no severe calcified, you cannot have.
Yes,
no.
Sir,
so first heart sound doesn't go with it. So A2OS,
long murmur,
functional class.
Yes, sir.
What about pH?
Yes, sir. Loud
P2 and no, pulmonary hypertension, right? Hypertension. Severity will have to go with pulmonary. It's very rare you have severe MS and no pH, yes. Or you have mild MS and severe pH, then you'll think of something else. Yes. So pH usually will go with it. Why severe MR? Is it common to have both severe? If you have a very pinhole.
In the older text, we don't mention that severe MS and MR do not go together.
Exactly.
Yes, sir. But
So you would. So when you are in confusion, what are the 5 or 4 key things that will tell you which is dominant? So my question to you is: is the MS dominant or the MR dominant?
What are the features dominant? For the dominant MR, actually the LV is down and out, sir.
No, examination is, points, yes. So one is apex beat. Apex beat will tell you which is dominant. So what is the character of apex beat? Is it tapping or is it volume over?
It's volume over of the hypodynamic type and down and out, sir.
Correct. So that is favoring MR. That is number one. Number two, what else? What else will tell you the severity? One is apex beat. Second is?
The diastolic seal, I mean, some textbook also mentioned diastolic seal as a severe.
No, dominant lesion you decide based on one symptom apart clinical features you need to tell me. One is symptom. So symptoms will decide. So you can get a MS now, which has become, you know, recurrence of rheumatic fever, and now the MR is severe. So that doesn't help you much. So symptom is one. So one is apex beat. Second is?
Second heart sound sleep.
Correct. Second heart sound. So what is the situation? So that will help you differentiate what? MS from MR, or it will help you differentiate aortic from mitral?
So basically, in severe MR, the split would be, that is why.
So you can get, so P2 loud with means of pH basically. pH will tell you severity. I mean, if there are two lesions, MS versus MR, chronic, then pH would usually go with
severe
MS
pH
or MR?
MS, sir. Severe pH would go with MS.
So this patient has got severe pH or no?
Severe pH, yes, sir.
Severe pH. So that's now going in favor of MS slightly. Then yes, something else? Anything else can tell you which of the two is a dominant lesion?
The four of the diastolic thrill, sir.
Diastolic thrill for MS? You have severe MR, you can get diastolic thrill? Yes, no. You have severe MR, sir. Can you get diastolic thrill?
Yes, sir. Severe.
So? JVP? Sir, told you something. Rather than your absent A wave, sir was more keen in? TR is more likely to be associated with severe pH. So severe pH. So is it likely to be associated with MS or MR? Severe pH with severe MR is not so common, right? More common will be severe MS. Right? So apex beat, blood pressure, JVP, second heart sound, pH will determine your severity. What type of apex, site of apex, character of apex. All the three things will be determining. So tapping apex, downward, outward, rather than lateral, you know, presence of pH, loud P2, parasternal heave, type of heave, you know, then MR versus heave of MR versus heave of pH, right? Is that also would be important, whether it's late systolic or it's pre-systolic. In a pH the parasternal heave of a PH would be pre-systolic or systolic, while late systolic, when if it's the LA, which is giving rise to the heave, the what is called as LV rock, if that is causing the heave or the lift, that will be late systolic. So that also will be determining which of the two is dominant. So that description should come. Your presentation should be to lead the examiner to your confirmation of diagnosis. So usually, this you have mentioned, severe MS, severe MR is fine. But when you are presenting something like this, the examiner is also confused as to which of the two dominant you are trying to justify. And then if the examiner is not kind enough, he'll catch you on the other side. He'll say, you're mentioning severe MR, why you mentioned severe PH? Or he may say, you're saying severe MS, why you're saying apex beat in 7, down and out? So rather than doing that, make the other finding or the second one as moderate, not severe. Again, PVH is fine, acceptable based on the functional class. PH, again, you'll go by the findings that you mentioned. Class 3, you mentioned. Normal LV function, not in. Heart failure, do you think it's not simple, not in CHF? So you mean CVHF in terms of RV dysfunction or you mean heart failure?
No raised AVP or right heart symptoms.
Okay, so you think that the AR is mild to moderate? So what is the murmur that you're hearing, the fourth murmur?
Likely because of the flow, sir, but that should have been a severe AR, but with the history.
So again, that is contradictory. You are mentioning a flow murmur in the aortic region. And you're mentioning AR to be mild to moderate. Again, that's contradictory. Then you'll have to justify. Maybe he has got anemia. Maybe he has got high output state. Maybe he's got beriberi. So you end up on talking all those things. Maybe he's now developed cardiac cirrhosis. Maybe he's... So then you'll have to find out justification for a flow murmur. So you just need to make sure that you're not mixing them. Or somebody can always argue what you're hearing on the base of the heart is actually the murmur transmitted from the MR. You're actually mixing it for the aortic murmur. So whenever, whatever findings you're speaking of, should be justifiable by your first the inspection, palpation, percussion, matching with the history, and then whatever findings you've confirmed by auscultation should determine the severity of your final diagnosis for each of the traits that you're going to mention. All right, sir, what do you...
Okay, fine. Now, I'll just put the way I will discuss this case, but I have to check the findings because findings are incompatible. Okay, here the diagnosis I'll put will be chronic rheumatic valvular heart disease, mitral plus aortic valve disease. So there is no controversy on that thing. Mixed mitral valve disease, mitral stenosis with regurgitation. If I am sure about the severity, I will put the severity. To me, when the left ventricle is in the seventh space outside the midclavicle line, I am expecting a very large left ventricle. The aortic regurgitation with a narrow pulse pressure, your blood pressure was 102 by 82. Am I right?
By 64, sir.
Okay, fine. Whatever you say, 106 by 60, that is around 46. Okay, that is not enough to produce that much of cardiomegaly. If the left ventricle is grossly, what is the LV size in mitral regurgitation severe? Usually normal. You look at the severity of mitral regurgitation. When it is end systolic dimension exceeds 40. So because there is systolic emptying to the LA. So LV systolic size is actually less than normal in mild to moderate cases. So significant cardiomegaly in mitral regurgitation is less likely unless they go in for LV failure. Your diagnosis page. Okay. So here I am not sure with your findings because the findings do not tally. This combination is also very unlikely. The diastolic events, you cannot give too much significance in presence of MR because the diastolic events will be exaggerated. Presence of thrill, my first question would have been, is it a MS or a flow rumble? So you said S1 is soft. It's a 39 order. With a sharp opening snap, we contradicted that. So is it third sound? Because there is a diastolic thrill, I am thinking in terms of associated mitral stenosis. Assessment of severity of mitral stenosis in presence of significant MR, the auscultatory findings can be misleading. Because the auscultatory findings, the diastolic events will be exaggerated because of the associated significant MR. But as sir said, severe PAH, and that is less likely in MR. It occurs only in late stages in small number of cases. So that I think it's okay, fine. But my question will be, why did you say the PAH is severe? That's a question. The question will be, what are the findings to suggest severe PAH? We always, students say moderate PAH, mild PAH, severe PAH. How will you quantify PAH? One, the P2 will be very loud and banging, ejection click, pulmonary regurgitation murmur, then tricuspid regurgitation murmur even heard during expiration, then sinus rhythm prominent AV. So why did you say severe PAH? You give me the answer for that. PAH, I agree. Why did you say it is severe PAH? You are in trouble now. That indicates PAH. No, sir was very keen because severe PAH, we have to diagnose mitral stenosis. I also agree. But why did you say it is severe PAH? I may say he has a grade 3 parasternal. Immediately the question comes from both of us, is it left atrial expansion or not? Because you are dealing with a severe mitral regurgitation, the parasternal activity could be due to systolic left atrial expansion. Then you will be asked the questions how to differentiate. That is an MD question, you should know that.
Yes,
then in this case, how did you assess the LV function? Why did you say the LV function is normal? Why did you say the LV function is normal?
So based on the history, if the patient...
Yes, passmal symptoms or PND. If it is pure MR, it occurs with severe LV dysfunction. If it is with AR, so the patient with the MR or AR develop class 3, class 4 symptom when they go in for LV dysfunction. Or when they develop atrial fibrillation, all those things. So how did you assess LV function in this case? Symptoms are not favoring LV function normal. Symptoms should favor LV dysfunction.
But there is also a stenotic lesion, so that could explain the...
Agreed, but why did you say it is normal? I find it difficult to assess. If it is MR, if this much of cardiomyopathy has occurred, I agree it is LV dysfunction. But AR can have a huge heart without LV dysfunction because that is the lesion where you get the largest LV size. That is cor bovinum. So that you could have avoided. It is not warranted. Normal LV function. Okay. Then the question was severe, then atrial control ventricularly. Fine. These are some of the comments which I have to make. For me, my diagnosis will be, sir, chronic rheumatic valvular heart disease, mixed aortic valve disease plus aortic regurgitation, mitral valve disease, mitral regurgitation, mitral stenosis, both significance I'll put. Examiners may differ, but with your findings, I may prefer mitral regurgitation severe because of that left ventricle. Opening snap, we are debating. We don't know whether it is third sound or opening snap, whatever it is. Then I will put as mild to moderate AR, agreed. Then severe PVH. I will write pulmonary arterial hypertension, atrial fibrillation with controlled ventricular rate, not in CHF, NYHA3. That will be my approach. Okay. Dr. Mohit, are we exceeding time? You are not contributing.
Perfect. Sumodh? Perfect, sir. I am just enjoying the discussion. It's great, sir.
Dr. Sumodh, you can also contribute.
No, it's a perfect decision, sir. I don't think we are enjoying, sir, the way both teachers in two different ways, you know, really, really, really marvelous together. Sir.
Okay, thank you. Fine.
Sir, for LV function, can we say that since the effects is not a sustained one?
Difficult things you should not volunteer if it is not warranted. For example, valvular lesion, you have to tell the severity, at least one or two lesions. You can say mixed mitral valve disease, mitral regurgitation with mitral stenosis. I think mitral regurgitation is dominant or mitral stenosis is dominant. That is the way we have been taught during our post-graduation because it is extremely difficult for me to say which is severe or which is dominant. I may be able to say because the LV is that much endowed, I may put MR as the dominant lesion. The long MDM can be explained because of the flow contributed by MR also. Opening snap, we have debated. So I may not concentrate on that. Severe PH, I may not use. I will say pulmonary arterial hypertension. And LV function, it is not warranted here. So unless you are asked that question, how to assess LV function in a severe mitral regurgitation with this much of this thing with symptoms? Symptoms indicate left atrial pressure elevation. How much it is contributed by the mitral stenosis? How much it is contributed by the LV diastolic pressure? We don't know. Okay, what is the apex in mitral regurgitation? Apex is ill-sustained because the ventricular systole is shortened. If you get a forcible apex, be it in isolated mitral regurgitation, it indicates LV dysfunction. If you draw the apex cardiogram, which I don't know whether you are being taught, apex cardiogram of isolated severe MR, the systolic time interval, you talk about, that's what we have been using, it is short. So you don't get a forcible apex beat as in AR. Because AR, there is a diastolic volume overload and a prolonged ejection time, because the whole volume has to be empty to the aorta. In mitral regurgitation, the systolic time is shortened. That is why A2 occurs earlier. And it is a rapid ejection which is occurring during the isometric contraction phase. Apex is contributed by the sustained isometric contraction phase. That is not there in mitral regurgitation. So we are unlikely to get a classical forcible apex beat in severe MR. You look into severe MR, unless they go in for heart failure or unless they have some other conditions like associated AR or hypertension like that. So the moment you have said the LV is down and out, and there is a forcible apex beat. Forcible means it is lifting and it is sustained, but not to the tune of AS or heaving. So these are finer aspects which never will be asked to you. Okay, fine.
Should I come in?
Investigation?
Investigation is with Topazia. Topazia, can you stop sharing the screen?
Yeah, please, please go ahead. So today we had a very different approach. Dr. Sudhir Kumar was giving, you know, slide-wise, line-wise analysis, which was very different from what we've been doing so far, Dr. Mohit, right? So
very important, because even I remember case of Eisenminger. So every statement carries a value, and every statement needs to be explained, you know, why it is. And that is one of the things that, you know, we have great learning. So Kumar is always a... It's you know, complete balance. So it's versus, you know.
Yeah, as Dr. Sumodh mentioned it, right? So two different kind of us.
Sir, you are muted, sir.
Yeah. What you need in a teaching program should be, there should be two teachers looking in two angles. Then the student is benefited more, because they are facing four examiners.
Yes, sir.
So, yeah, please go ahead, Dr. Zia. So, Dr. Abhishek, can you quickly tell us what does it tell you, the confusion around dominance, MS or MR, based on this ECG?
Sir, is the investigation discussed by the other postgraduate or the same person?
Sir, usually it's the same person. The presenter is usually different. Right? Dr. Abhishek has to do it, right?
I'm doing it, sir.
Yes, yes. So tell me, MS or MR? I'm confused, and I've done the ECG, and I'm confused with your findings that this is a dominant MS or a dominant MR. What are the findings of a dominant MR? In an ECG, what do you anticipate? Dominant MS, what do you anticipate? Okay, I'll give you a clue. Let's start from... Well, the mitral atrial fibrillation, no, so you'll not get LA. I'll give you a clue. Look at the axis. What happens to the axis?
Right axis.
What is the axis here? In degree, exactly.
One AVR is,
sorry?
120, sir.
So it's perpendicular to AVR, right? AVR is the equiphasic lead. That's how you approach it. AVR is, normal value of AVR is? AVR ka degree, how much is it, Abhishek? Normally, AVR is what axis?
Minus 150, sir.
Correct. So then you add subtract and add 90 to it. So where do you end up? AVR ka 90 degree. So where is, what's your axis? You spoke it and you got confused now. I don't know. You were right. You said it, Abhishek.
Sir, right axis 122.
Axis. You see, DM level, the left axis, right axis is undergraduate, postgraduate. DM level, you have to mention degree. So the axis of the, P wave ka axis is not measurable because of atrial fibrillation. QRS axis is this much degree.
120.
He has answered it.
Yeah, you said 120. Then why did you get confused? So 120, what does it tell you? MS or MR? Does it tell you anything?
Right axis deviation with... So in MS, there would be, because of the pH,
Correct. So pH width, that's one pH thing. Width, volume overload, anything? Yes, for the LV volume overload, where do you look for and what do you look for? You remember that axis-wise, there is a study 60 degree below in isolated MS, of course, valve area 1.3 above or less, right? When you go beyond 60 degree, valve area is less than 1.3. And then if you're beyond 110, your pH is two-thirds of the systemic. And if you're beyond 150, then your suprasystemic PA. That was an ECG-based valvular assessment of the mitral stenosis. But of course, that was isolated MS that the paper was talking about. But here, when it's 120 and you have both, now you'll be looking at the volume overload signs of the LV because of plus, the regurgitant flow. What are those?
Sir, plus there is also in positive R wave, right extension with R wave in V1.
No, R wave in V1 would represent what?
For RVH, I'm trying to explain.
Yeah, right ventricle hypertrophy. No, so volume overload of MR will be on the left ventricle. So what? Your apex is down out, seventh space, right?
Yes, sir.
So you're expecting what in ECG?
There should be LVH.
Not LVH. LV dilatation ko kaise read karte hain? How do you read LV dilatation or volume overload in an ECG?
LVH is upright T wave.
Yeah, so volume one is T, correct. So that you usually get what is called P mitral and T mitral, right? So T mitral, some people call it T mitral. That is in AR. You don't get in MR. MR, what do you get? Okay. So X-ray, what would you anticipate?
Can I?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir, please.
ECG, just I'll take only 2 minutes, ECG. Now, the approach in this case is, I want to know which ventricle is dominant. Okay. Now, obviously, the right ventricle is dominant, as sir said, right axis plus 120, and you have found a dominant R. There is a QR pattern. I am not sure whether it is because of the fibrillary wave. But both the complex show a QR. If it is genuine, it indicates, what does it indicate? A huge right atrium. If there is a Q wave with an R wave, the R wave is not very tall, it indicates a large right atrium. If there is a Q wave with a tall R wave, it indicates severe PH. That is one. Now, we feel that there are no left ventricular forces. But one technical thing I'll tell, this apex is in the seventh space. So your V6 is still medial to the apex beat. So if you place the lead a little out, like V7 or V8, you may get R wave, good R wave. Because the apex is in the seventh space, well outside. So your V6 now is not beyond the left ventricle. So that is one thing which I would like to have to say, that there is no LV. But definitely, as sir said, this is a right ventricular dominance. Second, what is the importance of these STT changes? That also you are saying in the right chest leads. That means that is the dominant ventricle. Whether it is digitalis or not, because the changes are seen in digitalis, it could be digitalis effect where the changes are seen over the in the leads facing the dominant ventricle. So the STT changes are seen in the right-sided leads only. So because the axis is to the right, there is an R wave without S in V1, probable Q wave, and STT changes in right chest leads. I think definitely his RV is dominant and his PA pressure is very high. If there is a Q here, that means there is a large right atrium also. These are additional informations based on literature. May not be in this case. Okay, thank you. X-ray.
See the chest X-ray view of the patient. So it's a normal bony case.
So MS or MR?
MS, sir.
Dominant.
The dilatation is much more, sir. Likely MS, sir.
Apex is LV, RV?
Apex is difficult to make, but yes, it's LV only, sir.
So lateral, there are theories to talk about lateral chest X-ray, looking at the RV, posterior two-third by 3/5, then you have Hoffman-Rigler sign, and then again fallacies around it. So we are not discussing that, but those are sometimes you can be asked kissing and kicking pattern, which is again fallacious, again not true to differentiate. Then some other hints with LV versus RV. So RV you would anticipate with a dominant MS, but again, mixed lesions, you can still have LV type of apex, cardiomegaly of LV type of apex with PH. So what kind of PH are you looking at here? arterial.
It's also evidence of PDH as well as PDH.
Sorry? Pulmonary arterial PDH hypertension?
Well. Yes, sir. There's also evidence of PDH as well as PDH, sir.
Okay. Echo?
Okay, okay. Before that, I would like to discuss the X-ray once more. Okay.
Yes, sir.
What I want from the candidate is, you have to, whenever X-ray ECG comes, you have to be very fast and precise. Don't wait for questions from us. You should know what are things you have to read in this X-ray. Apart from the routine chest X-ray, sir, there is cardiomegaly. Is it LV or RV? Sir, I'm not sure because it is not the classical RV or the classical AV. I want a lat review. So you score marks. Sir, there is left atrial enlargement as evidenced by double shadow, lifting up of the left bronchus and prominent left atrial appendage. There is pulmonary venous hypertension as evidenced by the prominent upper lobe vessels. And you can very clearly see the peribronchial cuffing. Usually seen in that right hilum, you can see one bronchus with a wall very thick. On the left side also, you can see a bronchus with edematous. So there is a peribronchial cuffing indicating transudation, which indicates severe pulmonary venous congestion. So there is evidence of PAH because the main pulmonary artery segment is full. The RPSIC is prominent. The right atrium is not enlarged. There is no superior vena cava prominent. This you have to complete. Don't wait for a question from our side. The SIRS question was, do you think it is more of severe MR or severe MS? Which will you favor? This cardiomegaly, will you favor MR or MS?
MR, because of the cardiomegaly.
But this cardiomegaly could be due to right ventricle. We are not sure. But what is the other point which strongly favors, which I feel that this is more likely to be dominant MS?
The LA enlargement as well as
LA enlargement is?
LA enlargement and as well as the
can occur in both. LA enlargement can occur in both. But in MR, severe, you expect larger LA. Larger LA. This is grade 2 LA because the LA is touching the right border. Here you can see draw the LA. I am using my pointer. So these are things which you have to tell. Sir, there are no curly lines, all those things. You have to tell that. I have a doubt whether you can see whether there is a calcification of the mitral valve. There is some bright spot seen there. Whether you can see it or not, I am not sure. We have to see the original picture. Okay, go ahead. Next.
Michael, four chamber view of the shows the mitral valve is thickened and the opening is.
Somebody can always end up asking you, what is this MI1.4? What is this 43HZ? What is this 19 centimeter? You know, so just be prepared. I'm not touching on to that. Somebody, if you put a color, they'll ask you the Nyquist limit that you have set. Why do you have set that Nyquist limit? What is the value of Nyquist limit? Why do you, when do you increase it? When do you decrease it? What is the frequency of the probe? So just be prepared for those kind of, you know, basic questions. Everybody knows them. I mean, if you don't, just make sure that you know all hi-fi stuff and you've just missed out on them. Just again, like hernia in a general surgery case.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead, please. So
the mitral valve is thickened and the opening is restricted. The tricuspid valve also seems thickened. There is presence of sect, can be appreciated. LA function is, looks normal. LA is
nothing is clear to me. So problem with my system.
We should be loud. Actually, we are not able to hear. Even I am not able to hear.
This is a apical four chamber view showing
your
mitral.
Why do you talk like that? We have been telling again and again. That is one thing in the examination. It should be extremely important. The examiner should be happy. If he gives some instruction, you should not deviate from that again and again. So you can make it clear by keeping that mic very close to your. Otherwise, we can't follow. Okay, go ahead.
Sorry. It's a apical four chamber view showing thickened mitral valve with restricted opening. The tricuspid valve also looks thickened. There is presence of sect can be appreciated. LV function looks normal. The chamber wise, the LA seems. Grossly enlarged and
without looking at the color, can you tell me is the MR severe or not? Just by this 2D image,
the MS is definitely severe, sir.
No, MR,
because of the large LA.
No, MR, sir. Large LA can happen in and chronic MS, LA. No? Okay, now that you've raised it, how what is the difference between the LA of a chronic MS versus the LA of a chronic MR? There's a typical name given for it on barium swallow. What is the name? small arc of a big circle versus big arc of a small circle. Know that? Kiska hoda? Who will get a big arc of a small circle and who will get small arc of a big circle? MS or MR? That's a barium swallow question. You know, our examiner, when I was doing undergraduate, my medicine teacher used to ask us this.
I am very happy because I am not a student of Dr. Kamal. I am not praising him as an examiner. Okay, fine.
Okay. The discrepant finding is likely the there is no cardio, I mean, the LVH or there is no cross LVH or RVH.
So LV dimension would give you an idea, right? Yes, so if you are dealing with an MR, do you think a severe MR will have this kind of an LA of the LV?
No,
yeah. Go ahead to the color.
No, just a minute, just a minute. Previous one, that question, I also, previous one, because the cardiomegaly, I find it difficult to explain because both the ventricles appear to be normal size. The picture in the ventricle is not good, but LV is normal. I can't make out the details of the mitral valve. The tricuspid valve is thickened. We have not seen the aortic valve. But one point in the echo to say whether it is MR dominant is look at the appendage. If the appendage is narrow and long, it is dilated, but it will be long and narrow mouth. Whereas if it is a broad, wide-spaced appendage, it is likely to be MR. That is a useful thing. Now, looking at the appendage, the base of the appendage, and looking at the shape of the appendage, if it forms a triangular shape, just like RA appendage, it is severe MR. That is one thing which is useful. Okay, go ahead.
Color Doppler across the mitral valve shows the regurgitation.
Go to Doppler, go beyond color. Look at the, yeah.
Okay.
So, supposing there was no MR, do you think this valve is suitable for balloon mitral? Yes or no?
It has a severe MR. I mean, noted to severe.
No, no. Assuming that there was no MR, I'm saying. Assuming that there was no MR.
Subvalvular apparatus also.
Correct. Subvalvular is bad. You look at the subvalve. Correct. Right.
And
go ahead. Next. Aortic valve. What do you think?
Aortic valve is thickened and doming is
correct.
Can be seen.
Go and show me the Doppler signal. I think it's already approaching 8. We need to finish quickly.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, go ahead. So you can present all your findings and then Dr. Sir Sudhay Kumar sir, and then we can take all the images quickly. What happens to distal lesion in face of a tight proximal lesion? Underestimated, overestimated, normal?
Underestimated, sir. In the case of proximal lesion, the distal will be underestimated.
So, do you think that you missed out on the AS with a mean gradient of 28 with a tight proximal MS? Do you think the AS is at least moderately severe?
Because proximal MS.
Yeah, but still, I mean, if you could get this gradient, go ahead. So that the proximal AS findings were masked, right? Go ahead. Next image. Okay, next image. So that's TR, correct? And the PAH, right? Severe PH. Any other image you have? Okay, go ahead. PR, correct. Go ahead. Next. Okay, so I think over to sir first.
Okay, yes. If I take previous, I want to discuss some points. Can you go back that aortic spectral trace, the first aortic spectral trace, before that you had a trace. Am I right? That was MR. The previous, this one is mitral. That is mitral. Okay, fine. I would be spending more time on mitral valve because the question was on balloon commissurotomy. You would have answered, sir, I would like to look at the cross-sectional view to see what are the commissures like. Okay, then come the subvalvular apparatus. Then only you should answer whether it is suitable or not. All these things, I'll score everything. Okay. Now you should know about the severity of MR. I will ask one or two questions. Next slide. What is the PA pressure in this case? That will be my question. What is the PA pressure in this case?
The severe PA.
My question is, what is the PA pressure?
Be louder and be clear.
severe TH.
No, value. I want the value. Is it 20 by 0? Is it 100 by 80? Like that. You pick it up, you measure it, and hand it over to Dr. Mohit. If he is right, reasonably right, fine. Okay, fine. Which is, tell me at least certain points to say that the AR is severe by echocardiogram. What are the criteria to say that AR is severe? Straightforward.
Yes, sir. I did not get the whole.
In planning the management, especially aortic valve intervention, what is the criteria to say that it is, C1, C2, and D? Okay. What is the criteria to say that it is severe? When you are going, there are so many things, but what is the criteria laid down? You have read that 2020 ACC AHA summary. Have you read that? Otherwise, you should read that. Very clearly given all the evaluations, what are the criteria, how to intervene, everything. I think encourage the student to read that because in practice it is important. It is not important only for your examination, but after examination is very important. So tell me the criteria to say that the it is C1, C2 or D, echocardiographic criteria. Aortic regurgitation.
For severe aortic regurgitation, the criteria would have to be reversal.
You keep your microphone closer.
Unable to hear any.
Diastolic reversal.
Pardon?
Volo diastolic reversal in the DTA.
Volo diastolic reversal in the DTA. Reversal in the
DTA.
That is the name.
Regurgitant volume more than.
That's right.
Regurgitant volume of more than 60 ml. Effective regurgitance orifice of more than.
Volume more than
60 ml.
65 ml.
The fraction more than 50%.
Regurgitant fraction more than 50%.
Regurgitant orifice, effective regurgitant orifice more than 0.4.
0.04. I think it is really 0.6, I think. 0.6 for AR and 0.7 for MR.
Sorry, 0.7
for 0.6. MR, I think. 0.6 for AR. Okay. Then
and, half time of half time less than 200.
Then the width, LVOT width, more than 64%. And pan-diastolic reversal where? In the upper abdominal aorta. In the, not, the, it is a, said to be one of the most specific thing, but less sensitive. To get the diastolic reversal in the abdominal aorta, from the epigastric approach, taking the descending lower part of the thoracic or upper part of abdominal aorta. That is said to be more specific, but less sensitive. Okay, that's all what I want to discuss. What is your final diagnosis for after the echocardiogram?
Rheumatic heart disease.
Yes.
With severe MS.
Yes. Go ahead. Yes. Why do you want to wait? Now it is, everything is clear.
Dr. Abhishek, are you there? Hello? Network issues?
Dr. Abhishek?
I can't hear him. I think network issues, probably we lost him.
Okay. Fine. I think then...
I think we can...
I think that's a...
marathon 2 hours.
Yeah.
That was Sumo would also...
Dr. Sumo then Dr. Mohit will be happy.
It was actually like, you know, blend of East and West, you know.
Now you have to have just
Sumod,
like...
unmute yourself, Sumod.
Okay, fine.
Sumod, would you like to say something?
Yeah. No, beautiful discussion. No, I think some of the key findings, he did not describe the LV apex and sorry, so, those kind of basic things you should not have missed. But otherwise, though, But the LV was not displayed properly, so we're not very sure. But it was enlarged right ventricle or LV palpated. It was
neither ventricle is enlarged.
There was cardiomegaly.
RV is also normal. I would have been happy to assess the tricuspid, but it appeared thick. They should have concentrated for the RV inflow signal, because the tricuspid I also thought, because it is a trileaflet in but three valvular lesion, mitral calcified. The aortic also thickened, it is more than expected, aortic stenosis, because The excursion is very little. Both their tricuspid leaflets are thin, thick and restricted mobility. They should have looked into the tricuspid inflow signal also. It's an organic tricuspid valve disease. Okay. It's a great case. I usually don't, in this examination, I usually teach because student is being evaluated by so many colleagues. Okay, he has the guts to present this thing. That itself indicates that these students are really good. Any student is volunteering to present means they are really good. Second thing, this student's performance is being evaluated by so many people, colleagues, not teachers. So they'll be under more stress rather than facing two of us. Okay. So I usually underplay the mistakes they have made. But indirectly, we'll be telling that these are things which he has to look for, especially that opening snap. We should not put too much stress on difficult findings. Because opening snap itself is a very difficult finding. The point which I want to convey to them is, when there is a diastolic thrill, to pick up an opening snap is not easy. I think they are not listening. I didn't want to present that. Because when there is a grade 4 diastolic murmur with a thrill, and opening snap is at the initial part of that murmur, it is, for me, it will be extremely difficult to say that there is a loud opening snap. Those practical difficulties, they don't know because they don't have the experience. We have the experience. We have made a lot of errors. We have been harassed by our teachers and colleagues. So we know that these are things which have to be careful. They have to mature enough to tackle our examiners and teachers.
I think
student is good because he has picked up findings. He has answered many questions, but he lacks confidence a little bit.
I think he didn't know the echo because the AS was missing. So Dr. Zia probably did not share the echo and the details with him. So that way we must compliment Dr. Abhishek. He was not knowing echo. It was very clear. And as you mentioned very clearly, sir, I remember my student presenting a case in the forum. He used to be, you know, the most not so confident guy amongst the batch. And I was told that he was the most confident when he appeared for the exam. Because this confidence that comes on presenting forum like this actually shoots up their confidence to a sky high. So it's actually, we must compliment the student and also Dr. Mohit and Dr. Sumoh and the format that they have created. The student who's presenting here, his confidence goes skyrocket, you know. I've seen it in my student. So I know it from firsthand.
I said that his confidence he lost probably because he thought that we were scolding him. I usually use strong words. That's a problem. That is my teaching. I want to impress upon them. Because he said axis plus 120 initially. I heard that he said axis is 120. But when we asked, he was he thought that he has made a mistake.
Right.
So he was, that was the problem. Right, that is the problem created by us. Okay. Fine. A great thing. Thank you very much, Mohit.
Thank you, sir.
We'll keep on both of you.
Very much impressed with Dr. Kamal. I learned a lot. I didn't know many things which you have asked. The test dose for benzathine, penicillin, I didn't know. What are the things? What are the side effects of that? So many things I learned, but it will not be there in my brain after half an hour.
Sir.
Okay, thank you. Nice to see
you.
Okay, good night.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Abhishek, for presenting a great
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
You're also present. Thank you, Dr. Siddharth Kumar, sir, Dr. Kamal, Dr. Samoth, and it's I'll be loading this whole presentation very soon on the YouTube. You can listen and note down all the questions as sir has and Kamal has enlisted, and you will enjoy listening to this case and sharpen your skills further. Next week, we're again coming up with something new. We'll catch up next Thursday, same time. Good evening. Have a safe weekend. Have an enjoyable weekend. Bye. I also thank Intas for joining us this platform.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you, sir. Bye. Bye.